Hi everyone, Mitch here with myrsilife.com, and in today's video I want to give you a 2-year update. I can't believe it's been 2 years since my initial RSI injury, and we'll share with you how I'm doing currently and the steps that I've taken to improve my health status along the way, and then I will also tell a bit about my story and how I was first injured and what I did in those 2 years. So let's get into it. First experienced computer-related RSI symptoms on October 14th, 2020. It was very sudden for me. And I remember it was a Wednesday night. I was working kind of late. It was 8 p.m. And I just experienced a lot of fatigue here in my right hand. My index finger experienced a lot of pain, not a lot of pain, but a lot of fatigue and fatigue up in my forearm, just using the mouse. And I was like, huh, that's weird. It's definitely not normal. I'll just go to bed and catch up tomorrow. So I went to bed, and the next day I worked for an hour and experienced a little bit more, you know, pain and fatigue, kind of the same symptoms, but definitely something I didn't want to exacerbate. So working remotely, it was the middle of the pandemic, no vaccine in sight, you know, and I had a lot of control over my work. So I said, you know, I can catch up on Friday, I can catch up on the weekend. I don't have to make a big deal about this. I'll just go to my meetings today and take it easy and catch up at another time. So then Friday rolls around and I worked for like 20 minutes before I just experienced such extreme pain in my right hand. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is bad. I can't work. It's been 3 days or the start of day 3. And so on October 16th that week, was a Friday, I reported the injury to my employer. I called my boss and said, hey, I'm injured and we got to do something about it. So I went to the doctor and we opened a workers' comp case. I naturally just switched to a left-handed mouse. I didn't really, you know, consider that this would be such a bad injury. And so I switched to left-handed mouse, and wouldn't you know, 6 weeks later, my left hand showed painful signs of injury. So 2 months later, you know, I was in pretty constant pain for those 2 months, and I started feeling a bit better in December around Christmas time. I had been using the keyboard and mouse a lot less as well at work. One thing that really stands out to me too is the intense emotional distress. I just remembered intense anxiety, heart pounding, late at night, and I'm in pain. The pain in my hands and the anxiety and catastrophizing about work just caused insane sleeplessness, depression, sadness, and anger, self-loathing, and, you know, again, catastrophizing. And so I would go to the doctor. They put you on like a cadence, like you go see him once a week or twice a month, something like that. And I found that the doctor wasn't very helpful. They were not sympathetic. I was like, hey, what am I gonna do? He was like, we'll see you next week, and we'll see you next year, and we're gonna close your case and then we'll reopen it in years from now because this isn't gonna go away for you. And when I was first injured, that was just terrible, terrible news to hear. So he was definitely more of an administrator. He was good at referring me to specialists who knew what they were doing. And those specialists, the occupational therapist and the nerve specialist and the acupuncturist, they were great. And I loved getting those services. And they were all covered by workers' comp. So I'm very grateful for that as well. The employer was also extremely helpful and accommodating within that first period of the injury. They granted me a lot of time off and they were very sympathetic, and they helped me offload a lot of the work to other team members. It helped me transition to being more of an ideas person rather than the doer. Okay, moving on here, let's talk about the first 6 months of the injury, kind of after the initial phase. In the workplace, my employer bought me a trackball mouse and the Kinesis keyboard that's kind of at the angle, and they helped at first, but they were not a solution. Eventually, I was in pain again. And so I learned alternative input tools. Of course, I learned Dragon Naturally Speaking. I learned Remote Mouse, which is an app for the tablet, which can control your mouse on a phone or tablet. Started using styluses. These have been great. And the 3D Rudder foot mouse and the foot pedal. These ones here. So those were helpful in my recovery and getting work done with my RSI. And then I, you know, was kind of unconsciously, not really setting goals for this, but because the work had to be done, we had to be creative about how to get it done, I began to exercise my interpersonal skills. I started to delegate, started to be more of the project manager and not so much the person in the project. And I stopped trying to be the guy who got all the credit. I thought to myself, you know what, I've been doing this a number of years, and there's a lot of, you know, newer talent here that really would benefit a lot more from getting the credit for this project. So that turned out to be a very helpful skill. And then in my personal life, in November of 2020, right after the injury, like 2 weeks after the injury, I started mindfulness and meditation practice. I read the book Mindfulness in Plain English, which was really, really great to help me deal with stress. And I also adopted a puppy and kitten. I'm not advocating that anybody go and adopt a puppy and kitten if you have RSI, but I just recognized that I needed more positive brain chemicals in my life. I needed more dopamine and serotonin, and pets can do that. So I decided to become a dog person and a cat person, and I love my pets. I also hit the gym. I worked with a personal trainer twice a week, which was expensive, but I was still employed, so it was okay. And I worked with my occupational therapist. I would take notes from my occupational therapist and say, hey, OT, I wanna do this and that in the gym. I wanna work the upper body in this way, or do bench press or whatever. And she would say, okay, here's ways to be safe. Here's some accommodations you can give to your personal trainer to make those accommodations. And we would give status updates both to the personal trainer and to the occupational therapist. So that was just an awesome efficiency that helped accelerate my recovery as well. So about my workouts, I would lift weights in the gym 3 days per week, including a thorough 15 to 20 minute foam roll and lacrosse ball self massage. So you can lay down on this on your back, you can push your arms against the wall and just roll out all the muscles to loosen everything up before usually a 30 to 45 minute weight workout with those accommodations that I mentioned. And then 20 to 30 minute cool down with mindfulness and meditation in the sauna. So the steam sauna and the dry sauna were both really great. So my total gym time was usually an hour and a half to 2 hours, three times a week. And then I talked about the occupational therapist. Walking the dog as well helped me drop 25 pounds. I actually hadn't considered myself, you know, fat or overweight or anything, but it was a great thing for my fitness. And just walking is a really low impact way to burn a lot of calories during the day and keep that activity and that heart rate up. I started journaling. That goes along with the kind of the mindfulness practice. That's very, very helpful. We talked about that in the Why You Should Read It's Not Carpal Tunnel Syndrome book. They highly recommend journaling. I also had to mourn the loss of some hobbies that were pretty big parts of my life. It was more difficult for me to ride a bicycle. I couldn't pull the brake levers with my hands anymore. It caused pain. So mountain biking used to be a really awesome joy in my life, but I had to give that up, and I still am sad about that. But I might go back. I also gave up video games. Video games would cause pain almost immediately after playing, you know, 10 to 15 minutes would cause pain. And so I decided to give up video games. And that was also a tough choice, but a quick choice, where I realized that this was a factor in my life that wasn't providing me any benefits. So I needed new hobbies to fill the void in those first 6 months. I started writing the myrsilife.com blog, opened the website, started recording videos. Weightlifting was a good substitute, as I mentioned. And then reading, I got more into reading since I couldn't play as many video games and I had a lot more time on my hands. So reading and audiobooks were a great escape and a path to learning and recovery, because you could read health books and nonfiction. I also read a lot of fiction. And then to kind of fill that nerdy fantasy void, I got into Dungeons and Dragons. And that filled the gap that video games used to occupy. I have a great network of friends and family who help Dungeon Master and really help everybody get into it. So that's awesome. That's still something that I do regularly. Okay, so let's now talk about the last year and a half. So beyond 6 months. In the workplace, I finished up that main project. It was a project that took, you know, maybe a year and a half, but I finished it up, passed on a lot of notes and documentation and work to the team that I'd worked with, and then submitted my 2 weeks notice. And I quit my job in August of 2021. I began promoting myself on LinkedIn and in interviews or in my professional networks as an independent contractor. I landed a few small jobs, nothing really super sustainable or groundbreaking, but enough to ensure and give me confidence that being independent was gonna be an okay choice. And I got a part-time job as a finance and consulting instructor at my old business school. So that was also an avenue that I was allowed to pursue thanks to being independent. And teaching was a really good avenue for me to earn some money and progress my career while recovering. spring. I taught in the spring of 2022, so I had the fall of 2021 to slowly, with my dictation and with my, you know, taking a lot of breaks, build the syllabus, build the homeworks, build the course, basically. So flipping over to the personal life beyond 6 months time frame, I sold all my video games in July of 2021. It took a year and a half to finally say goodbye to a big old box of video games, and it didn't sell for very much money, but I got rid of it, and that did feel like something that, a sacrifice that I made for myself. And then I continued writing the blog and started that up in September of 2021. The first video was released in November of 2021, and then I had a lot more time on my hands too, because I'm not playing video games, I'm not working as much, so I upped the workouts to 4 days a week, which was just great for my fitness. And I stopped seeing the physical therapist due to the cost, but I had learned enough from that person to feel comfortable and safe doing heavy weightlifting on my own. So let's now talk about my current status. Where am I at today? How do I feel day to day? How much typing do I do and all that? I actually feel pretty good. I don't feel constant aching pain in my hands. However, flare-ups can happen very easily. I realize that I'm kind of living on a knife's edge when using the computer. And any more than maybe 20 or 30 minutes of typing in a row or constant typing will inflame my symptoms for a couple days after that. So I still have to be very careful, and I do not use a mouse. Because I can type for maybe 20 or 30 minutes every 2 to 3 hours, that's usually enough for me to get by typing for my day-to-day communications. And whether that's Microsoft Teams or short emails, if it's a long email, I'll switch to dictation. So that's how much I type, and I eventually, over time, want to reduce that amount of typing to less and less, just because it causes me pain. And I know there's an argument out there like, oh, you should, you know, practice so that you can type again. I'm done typing. I don't want to type. I don't care about typing anymore, and there are plenty of tools out there that help me get around that. I got a job in the field of corporate finance consulting. That's kind of my field, and I was a manager there. I still work with them a lot. My duties are training and mentoring new employees, doing sales presentations, talking to clients, telling them about what we do, going to conferences. I don't do any of the modeling myself. I don't do any of the spreadsheets. Like I said, any more than 20 minutes every 2 to 3 hours will cause a relapse of pain symptoms. So it's just a few emails and instant messages every day. And because I'm employed and doing work, you know, roughly 30 to 40 hours a week, I don't have as much time to do some of the other health activities. Like, I usually do workouts 2 to 3 times per week now, more often 2 times. It's a balancing act on how much workouts I can do per week. So in conclusion, I'm in a much better spot. Oh my gosh, the recovery since I got injured has just been pretty good. Like I said, I can still relapse, but as long as I'm careful and mindful and not doing stupid things on the computer, I can handle it. And I've been able to handle it for about the last, you know, year and a half. And so here are the top 3 things that have helped me most. And the first one is asking for help from other people. So whether that's coworkers, friends, the internet, your physical therapist. Speaking of help from other people, I've started seeing a mental health counselor. I'm just seeing a lot of benefits from that. If you've never considered therapy, I encourage that. And you may need that if you're a workaholic. Workaholism is a legitimate addiction, and you can see an addiction counselor for it. So, second thing that's helped me the most is fitness. I've talked a lot about this in this video. Walking and lifting, those are my fitness activities, and I can do that with my dog, I can do that with my friends. It brings me a lot of joy to participate in fitness activities. And then the third thing that's helped me the most is mindfulness and meditation, and just finding a quiet place to let my thoughts go and allow them to do their thing, and learning to forgive yourself, learning to be kind to yourself. All of that's very, very important. And folks with RSI typically tend to be very hard on themselves. So mindfulness can help you break that habit. So thanks so much for watching. I hope this helps. I hope this was interesting to you. And best of luck in your recovery journey.